Help everyone explore new worlds and ideas. Support your PBS station.
The chef David Kinch balanced beans, occasionally stepping out from behind the line. Even the things you are most passionate about can wear you out if you don't take a break.
Let's go. What's missing?
Growth comes from exploration, collaboration, and experimentation, both inside and outside of the kitchen.
Doesn't look bad.
Enter the mind of a chef.
The sun is an ingredient. This is the fun part in cooking. Cheers. Some sort of balance between your personal and professional life. That's really hard to do in our industry because it's so relentless.
Let's go.
But a lot of chefs talk about at some point in time in their career, they say, I've been doing this, I work at 1 o'clock in the morning, my feet hurt, I don't have a personal life. What can I do to get out? And they're leaving something that they've been very passionate about for the majority of their young life. Yes, I understand to learn your craft, sometimes you have to go through these systems. It's like military, you know, a level of discipline and working long, long, long hours. But to get away and to unwind and to relax is very important. It's funny how you take a break and you get really isolated and you end up cooking. There's something very appealing about that. I used to have chefs ask me to make them omelets to see if I could get a job or not.
I don't think that happens anymore. Like,
it doesn't happen anymore. I mean, what would you do for a cook? What would you have them make, you know, if you want to see if they can walk the walk?
I make them open oysters.
Oh, no punctured bellies?
Oysters and clams.
Carlo Maracci is the chef and owner of Blanca and Roberta's in Brooklyn. He's a very good friend of mine. I wanted him to come out to California and show him a little bit about where I've been, where I'm from. I had a humbling experience about 5 or 6 years ago. A visiting chef, I had Alain Passard come and cook in my restaurants. And every night at the end of the service, he'd be like, make me dinner. And I'd have to cook him dinner. And one night he says, make me an omelet. I made him an omelet and I was about ready to go out. And the sous chef was like, oh, no, 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 no. They proceeded to show me how to do it. And it's really, really brilliant. And it kind of flies in the face, I think, that you and I were always shown how to make an omelet. And omelets were always one of those things where there was a way to do it, and this is how it's done. Mm-hmm. And you know, if you do it other ways, like a frittata or you fold roast, then it's something different. But an omelet is an omelet is an omelet. It's a perfect representation of what can happen to eggs when they're cooked perfectly. Eggs at room temperature, not cold out of the fridge. I'm gonna do 3 whole eggs.
Because I like to do 3 whole eggs and then 1 yolk.
Okay, let's do that.
We don't have to do that.
Let's do that. Okay. Just a touch of water. I use a fork instead of a whisk because you don't want to incorporate air into it. Essentially, you just want to homogenize it. You want to bring it together. It starts to lighten up a little bit in color. But to me, this is ready to go. And I have not added any salt into this at all. There we go. Come together, no color on the bottom. They're not running on the inside. Really, kind of the beauty of the whole thing is it's just eggs and butter, but by technique, it kind of really elevates it to a really beautiful texture. Because this is key. So it's shaped. Just give it a little bath in the homemade salted butter, just enough to make it shine. The only salt that's been added to it, we're adding to it right now. To me, that's a good omelet.
This is delicious.
Would you hire me?
I would. I'm gonna be the junior breakfast cook. The omelet bar.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
Yeah.
This is raw goat's milk here. Well, I'm gonna try and make a real simple fresh farmer's cheese. The cheese picks up a bit of a smoky flavor. I'm gonna really dig it. As fresh as you can get right there. Some fresh cream, not a lot. And I'm gonna put a little cow's milk in just to enrich it a little bit. Some sea salt. I'm gonna warm this up. This is the first time I've ever done it on a wood fire, but I think it's gonna work. Ready? It's starting to form the skin, so it's ready. Nice. Throw me the knife?
Knife?
Thank you, chef. You're an amazing pot.
Something very goth about it.
It's getting really close to a boil. I'm gonna let it continue to drain. Well, we have lunch. I'm fascinated by pizza. I think the relationship between the person who's making the pizza and the oven is really important. The best pizza I ever had are people who are really fanatical about their ovens. There's people who make it, who just chase it their whole life. They still don't feel that they got it down.
Mother Teresa said that she felt the presence of God once for 5 minutes.
Was she eating pizza?
And she spent the whole rest of her life dedicated to what that moment meant. Maybe all it takes is one good slice.
Evan Shilley is a legendary character in Northern California, original gangster at Chez Panisse, one of the greatest cooks I know. I knew that Carlo and Evan would get along really well.
Can you give me a little chili flake? You grow these chilies here? You dry these here?
No, I have a day job.
Some of that pecorino.
Pecorino. Come with the guanciale, it's amazing.
Oh, this guanciale my dad and I make. We dry in the basement of the house on Long Island.
Onion petals.
That's the sweet spot.
Hot dough.
Yeah, that looks pretty good.
Hurry up and spice it.
If that was like another planet.
The guacanale is delicious.
I don't know how we're going to top that one.
How about some fava beans?
Fava beans? On a pizza pie? Che pazzo!
I'm going to take a look at my cheese.
Oh, yeah.
Look at that.
What's that? What's that, goat?
It's goat. This should be pretty good. We have just a real quick farmer-style ricotta made with goat's milk. And these roasted fava beans with the cheese, I think will be great. Just walking around here, saw the savory. Wasn't even thinking about putting savory on a pizza.
Yet here we are.
And here we are.
Here we find ourselves. Put the savory around it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Good.
A little bit too much.
Sure. Sorry, chef. Please don't send me home.
I think the mint would go really nice, too. Though, mint on a pizza sounds kind of odd. I guess we're going to find out.
Wait, if it's a flowers?
It's gotta be a flower pizza.
Oh. Mamma mia.
Do not laugh.
Apply the garnish.
Okay.
Sounding pretty good.
Let's see how it tastes.
That's just really beautiful. That tastes pretty too.
Sold.
Well, it's not starting. I think it needs a jump.
You wanna bump start it?
Yeah.
You're neutral?
In neutral. Faster, Carlo.
I can't get any more up that hill by myself.
Okay. Stop.
All right, so what's the plan? You can go down this way?
Yeah, down this way.
All right, ready?
Never turn. All right, we need to jump it.
We're getting what we deserve right now.
All right, you're hooked up. Grab the engine.
Got it? So we're gonna do the seaweed sunchoke dish.
Where did this dish come from? It's vegan. It's a vegan dish, right?
Yeah, it ended up being, we didn't really think about it, but we just finished it and we're like, oh, it's vegan.
So you didn't create a dish for a vegan scenario at the restaurant?
Yeah, it worked out that way. We had bees on the roof, so we had a lot of honeycombs, and we had sea lettuces in from our main guy. We wanted to do something with the honeycombs and the seaweed in a fun way, and we just started fooling around. It took like 6 months to figure this dish out. Even though it's really simple, it was a lot of trial and error to find the right seaweed that balances slowly well with the honey.
So it was the balance of flavors that was the hardest thing?
Yeah, and the mouthfeel too was really important for this dish because there's a lot of texture. Sunchokes I like a lot because they have a ton of inulin, which when they're stored turns into sugar, which makes them really sweet but not being too starchy, which is nice.
What am I doing? Am I laying
this? Just lay those out flat because we're going to dehydrate those. You're on the dehy-duty, chef.
I know how to do that.
This is ulva, or sea lettuce. It's harvested from Maine. Yeah. We get it in, we rinse it, and then dehydrate it overnight.
It also has a lot of clinging salinity.
It does, so it sure does. You... And the green almonds. It's a fresh almond.
An almond is actually the kernel of the almond fruit. Are those hard to find on the East Coast?
Yeah, they don't exist on the East Coast.
They come from
California, yeah. We try to get stuff from all over. We have our own garden, we grow a lot of stuff that we use. Probably 85% of what we use comes from the East Coast. But, you know, sometimes something just needs something that every once in a while you can't get. I think that's okay.
It is okay.
These are the sunchokes that we just cut. It's working hard. Nice.
And it caramelized so fast.
Really, really nice and quick.
That looks great.
No, it's nice, right? It's like sunchoke crackers. I don't want to eat it. We're gonna make the sauce now. We've got a little bit of soy milk here. Then we'll add a little bit of the sunchoke stock. So basically we'll just let this cook down for a little bit, and then we'll puree it, pass it through a top filter.
Okay, so it picks up the caramelized flavor.
Yeah, it does. Yeah, but not too much, just enough to make it a little toasty, but nothing crazy. It kind of just tastes like ice cream base at this point.
Sunchoke makes a great ice cream, because all those sugars.
Mm-hmm. All right, so we're right there, pretty much. We'll put it in a Vita Prep, buzz it, and then pass it through a coffee filter. That'll be our sauce. Well, voila! The magic of television.
Pretty fancy for a vegan dish.
Yeah, I know, right? Oof, man.
What do you start with first?
Sunchoke. Then we'll do a little bit of the toasted seaweed. The seaweed moves when you plate it. It looks really cool. National Geographic right there. Then we just do a little bit of the honeycomb. And then for the green almond, I like to actually open them up, squeeze the gel out.
Oh, nice.
It's a little messy, but it looks nice.
I'm gonna taste it too, it's kind of aromatic. What about some coriander?
Oh, you have some? Oh boy. It's done, I think. It's a vegan surf and turf.
For me, a true vacation is just recharging everything. Nothing else matters for a while. And then you come back and you're almost like a different person.
There is a good stretch of one for San Francisco where you become completely disconnected. Phones don't work. You get no signal of any kind. And nowadays, that's going off the radar. That's the big deal. And I like that, you know, to me, when I want to get away, it's really important that that happens. I think as the restaurant has become more popular, it's become more important to find the ability to drop away. Make no mistake, it's a meet-off. There are no rules.
I've always associated great steak cook with Carlos. Carlos is one of the first people that I heard about who was aging meat past the norm to get more flavors and to get more nuance and character out of meat. And always great sourcing. I still don't know where he gets his beef from. Your steak is definitely an animal with Wagyu in it.
Yeah. Just a really, really even pattern of marbling all along, as opposed to being grouped in certain areas and not evenly distributed.
I have a West Coast source that I like very much, but I also think it's really incredibly different. Hence the purpose for meat off.
Yeah, we're going to celebrate the difference.
Right?
Yeah.
They're both strip loins. They're both on the bone.
You're taking it off the bone, David?
I'm just taking this one bone out because I'm going to cut it thick. There's many different ways to cook meat. You can cook them slow. You can cook it really, really fast for this particular cut. I like to go a really, really high heat, but trying to have as much control over it as possible. On a grill this big, you want to have a really, really super hot spot and another place that's not so hot. So I can control the temperature by moving the meat on and off the heat. Beef gelatin to me burns very, very clean, but it's tremendously hot. It burns almost smokeless, but you use the hardwood because we're outdoors. For beef, I like it because it burns really, really hot, but it burns really fast.
Yeah.
I'm getting really close.
Yeah, me too. It
looks like I'm using a lot of salt, but it's all gonna cook right off.
That's amazing. I salt probably not as much as other people do because I'm a big fan of salting it after it's cooked. I don't put pepper on it at the beginning either because pepper burns. When pepper burns, it gets really acrid and bitter. So it's just meat and salt. When people taste this, I tell them it tastes like the steaks that your fathers and your grandfathers used to have. You know, before animals were bred for efficiency.
You do those crosshatches?
Yeah.
Still got it.
Right. When those flames hit the beef, a little bit's okay, but a lot's not okay. I think it starts making it taste like the charcoal. How important is the char to you?
I like a nice one, but nothing crazy.
You don't like that super crusty, like.
Well, on aged beef, it doesn't work well. You lose a lot of the nuance.
It dries out.
Yeah. The thing is, the loins are so big. It's, yeah. You can age it for a really long time.
And how long was that?
3 or 4 months. 30 days on this, you know, it's nothing. You lose a little bit of water weight, but that's it.
Yeah, amazing, huh? It can get mesmerizing, can it? Just watching the fire.
Cooking outdoors, there's something relaxing about it. Especially if you're working with an open fire. It immediately becomes more rustic. It can put you much more attached to the act of cooking. Usually it's not for an event. You're cooking for yourself or friends, so it's much more intimate. It's much more personal. You also don't feel a lot of pressure to analyze things. It's more about eating well and having a good time, which is very important on a day off. We're moving away from the period where it's just heads down, work, 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 all the time, because it beats people up. You have better longevity, you have more creative powers, I think you live a more healthy life, if you find that balance. I've only had one restaurant, and that is because I always like going to work. I like working at night, cooking food, making people happy. It's kind of what drives me. And I've learned to accept that. But how long is that going to happen? It's just learning when to take time off, learning when to recharge my batteries, learning to delegate, which is really the last thing chefs learn to do. I can do it better than anybody that works for me, so I'm going to do it. As opposed to just like taking a deep breath and realizing that you've trained people and you trust them and you're paying them to do the job and to actually take a step back and let them do it. To make that happen, you have to accept I'm going to step away. And you know what you're going to find out? Sometimes it runs even better. Because that's part of balance. That's part of how it happens.